एक्चुअली, एंड
या
नाउ आई
इट्स
थिंक इट विल बी ओके
इट्स एक्टिव नाउ.
ओके
या
ओके ओके
थैंक यू चंदन.
शुड आई शेयर मी.
या गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. वेलकम टू द आफ्टरनून सेशन ऑफ इन द थर्ड डे ऑफ यूक्यू 20. एंड नाउ दिस सेशन विल बी चेयर्ड. आई थिंक it was actually initially it was decided that Pooja Thakur will be chairing, but I think she is not, I don't see her in the participant list, right? Yes, she is not there, right? Can anyone set just quickly? No, she is not. Okay, so I think Shoptoshi Rai from the QIC group at HRI can chair this session. So Shoptoshi, mic is yours.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. So it's a pleasure to welcome back Himadrida at HRI, at least virtually. So we are eager to hear your talk on non-classical light from mesoscopic spin ensembles. And Himadrida has been working with ma'am for a long time, and he's now currently a postdoc at Imperial College London. So, over to Himadrida.
Yeah. Thank you, Saptashi. Can you see my screen, and is my voice audible?
Yes. Is it?
Okay. Yeah. Thank
yes,
you,
clear.
Thank you, everyone at UQ, the organizers, for inviting me to give this talk. As Saptashi mentioned, so all my preliminary work during my PhD was mostly done with Aditi Sende and Ujjwal Sen. So in some sense, even though I didn't officially graduate from HRI, HRI is my academic home. So it always feels nice to talk to everyone here. And yeah, and I'm really, it's my pleasure to give a talk for UQ, which we started, I think, for the first time in 2015. So yeah, so what I'm going to talk about today is non-classical light from mesoscopic spin ensembles. Now, this is not in tune with what you probably were hearing in the other talks. Like, it's not strictly from a quantum information perspective, but it's very relevant from the perspective of quantum technology as we know it today. And that would be one of my main motivations of the talk. I would try to tell you how light matter interaction and cavity QVT play a significant role in building quantum computation tools, as well as other aspects, quantum protocols, single photon sources, and how there are still a lot of important theoretical regimes that you can work on, where you can use tools from many body physics and quantum information theory to study these systems. So I will, my talk would be a bit introductory, and if you think I'm not being very clear or rigorous at some point, we can always discuss the technicalities later. You're free to drop me an email and I can clarify the points from you, and any other thing, like any technical aspect of the method or the theory, we can discuss later. So yeah. So, okay. Yeah, so I'll start off with a very brief and poor man's introduction to quantum optics and how the entire field of cavity QED came into being. So if you think about quantum optics, it all basically started with Weisskopf and Wigner, who basically gave an explanation of how spontaneous emission takes place. So if you have an atom that is excited to some energy level, how do you understand that this atom would naturally decay? And if it decays, or if it comes down to its ground state, what does its emission look like? And this was explained by Weisskopf and Wigner, who basically introduced the concept of interaction with the vacuum QED, or the vacuum fluctuations of quantum fluctuations of the vacuum state. And they basically said that what you would get is a Lorentzian around the transition line of the atom. And later on, there would also be a Lamb shift along with such spontaneous emissions from the atom. Significantly, what people found out is you don't necessarily need to have this simple spontaneous emission. you can actually enhance this spontaneous emission. And how do you do that is by you can place this atom inside a cavity. And once you place the atom inside a cavity, you change the density of states that are available to you. And this overall has an effect of increasing your rate of spontaneous emission. But once you put your atom inside a cavity, you're not limited to just enhancing spontaneous emission. You can have the famous James Cumming model, where you have a strong coupling between the atom and the photonic modes, and they can basically exchange energy with each other. And this, in some sense, puts us in a very comfortable position in terms of future quantum technology and even quantum information, because you have a strong coupling between light and matter. And then you can think about a lot of things, how energy is transferred from one system to the other, how you can have quantum correlations that build up, how you can have entanglement between the two. And a lot of this strong coupling regime and a lot of interesting physics naturally starts to build up. And all this culminated, all this culminated in the famous experiment by Sergei Haroche, who basically placed these Rydberg atoms inside high Q cavities and was able to generate the Rabi oscillations that you see in James Cumming model. And in the process, he gave birth to this entire field of cavity QED, for which he was ultimately awarded the Nobel Prize. Okay, so since then, a light-matter interaction has gone into a completely different dimension. You still have real atoms inside a cavity. This is the famous Michel Lukin's group in Harvard, where they basically place rubidium atoms inside this nanophotonic structures. This is the Rauschenbottel group in Vienna, where you can again have rubidium atoms placed inside whispering gallery modes. And these are extremely expensive setups. You have extremely high quality cavities interacting with the atom, and you can get the strong coupling regime and exchange energy and create a lot of interesting quantum physics. But in the last decade or so, light matter interaction has gone into a very different kind of systems. Now you do not need a real atom. You can have different kinds of systems that talk to each other, and they are so-called artificial atoms, and they are part of what are called hybrid quantum systems. So you can have a quantum dot, which is placed inside a photonic nanocavity, and they still behave like your atom and cavity interaction. On the other hand, you can also have optomechanical resonators, like this is from the famous Aspermeyer group in Vienna, and you have superconducting circuits, where superconducting circuits can give you qubits as well as give you superconducting resonators, and you can make the qubits talk to the resonators, very similar to what you would have in a typical light matter interaction. And I think some aspects of hybrid quantum systems and quantum technologies would also probably be covered in the keynote talk today. Yeah, because a lot of this work is being done in Vienna. So in the study of light matter interaction and spin cavity systems, there are two very specific theoretical domains that come, not only theoretically, but in terms of technology and systems. So you can have a system where you have a macroscopic ensemble, as well as you can have a system where you just have a few spin, just one single spin inside the cavity, like how Sergei Haroche initially designed the system. And both these systems play very different roles. So the macroscopic ensemble, you can look at collective behavior. Your entire ensemble behaves like one bosonic operator. And this is typically used in quantum memories and systems like that. Whereas in the few spin system, your entire physics is very non-classical. You just have a single atom, and this interacts with the cavity, creates entanglement. You can look at, so there was, I think, a talk by Ohana, and she was looking at how entangled atoms between two cavities talk to each other. So these are all in the few spin limit. And so in terms of the theory you use to study the system, these are also very different. So if you have a macroscopic ensemble, you can basically work in the semi-classical limit. We just simply write down the rate equations of the system, and you can solve for these rate equations. So these are famously known as Maxwell Block equations. But one important part is, in the semi-classical limit, you can essentially ignore all the correlations between your spins and your photonic modes. So in some sense, you are giving away a huge chunk of your quantum behavior to get this semi-classical advantage while solving the system. On the other hand, if I want to study the few spin system, I basically have to solve the exact Hamiltonian. And by solving the exact Hamiltonian, I can get the entangled energy states, entangled states of light and matter. And this is where all the entanglement and the non-classical physics lie. But you can see you get two different regimes and they don't really talk to each other with the current setup. So our idea was to come to a mesoscopic limit. So I really want to see this quantum memory and collective behavior, but I don't want to throw away all the entanglement or all the non-classical physics that I have. So can I come to a mesoscopic limit where you have around 10 to 100 spins, but you need to solve the system exactly? So in this thing, our idea was to use a variational renormalization method. So this is similar to how you would implement DMRG or matrix product states. Can we bring that idea to solve light matter interaction in spin cavity systems? Right. And one of our main aim was trying to achieve a collective behavior, which I will explain in the following slide, what do I mean by collective behavior, and try to get some non-classical physics out of it. So, yeah, sorry.
Can you mute everyone, please?
Okay. Sorry, should I continue? Yeah. So, one of the interesting things you see in collective systems in large spin ensembles is this quantum memory-like operation. So one of the first advantages you get is it is much easier to achieve strong coupling. So for example, take the case of nitrogen vacancy centers, which are very popular and used a lot in study of quantum technology. So nitrogen vacancy centers, each of the two-level systems are very, very weakly coupled to the cavity. But just because you can place so many of them together, you get an enhancement by a square root of n factor, which allows you to then go to the strong coupling regime. So collective interactions in ensembles give you some kind of an advantage. So compare this with the experiments done by Sergei Hirosh, where he really had to use very expensive and high quality mirrors to achieve strong coupling. On the other hand, in nitrogen vacancy centers, just by taking so many two-level systems, you can achieve it. Secondly, you can have these quantum memory operations. So you create what are called these spectral combs. So you have an ensemble which has this fixed frequency distribution, and then you can get a quantum memory-like operation. So if you can look at my pointer, so what you have is you put a small input pulse shown by this gray region in the figure, and then after 100 nanoseconds, you have an output that gives you the time. So similarly, this can be expanded to other kinds of multimode quantum frequency combs. And some of these experiments were actually done by the Nikola Giza group, who's a keynote speaker tomorrow. So yeah, so this was one of the, some of the experiments that he did in his group. And again, he had this macroscopic spectral frequency comb or atomic frequency combs. And by, if you push in light there, you get this periodic revivals, which are very sharp revivals at fixed points of time. So what's basically happening here is the information that you initially put in is being stored in the spectral comb, and at regular intervals of time, it's being released from the cavity, right? So what we want to do is we want to achieve such a spectral comb, but using a mesoscopic spin ensemble. And again, I would reiterate, our idea is to get quantumness out of it. Can we get quantumness? So what we do is we theoretically take say 105 spins, which are arranged in a spectral frequency comb like this. And what we want to do is we want to combine the collective features of 105 spins with some non-classical physics. And this is doable. This is a setup using transmon qubits in the group of Johannes Fink. And we are trying to build something like this using superconducting circuits. But yeah, for a much smaller number of spins, maybe 7 to 15 or, oh, okay, so there are 5 out here. Yeah, maybe scale from 5 to 10 or something like that. Yeah, but that's the idea. But how do we solve this? So typically, if you want to solve light matter interaction, you would write down what's called a James Cumming Hamiltonian. So Tavis Cummings Hamiltonian is basically James Cumming Hamiltonian, but for N emitters or N spins. And so you can write down a simple Hamiltonian. So these are basically your spin operators, your photon operators. GK is basically the coupling between light and matter. And then you can have an external driving field, which basically inputs some external excitation into your system in a coherent manner. What does it mean to solve the system? To solve the system exactly, you would basically need to solve this Lindblad-Yund. Now, if you're, what I was saying earlier is, now if you're in the large macroscopic regime, you can use this Lindblad-Yund to write down simple rate equations like Maxwell Bloch equations. But if you're in the microscopic regime and you want to look at the quantum thing, then you have to solve this Lindblad-Yund exactly on a particular basis, and then keep all the entangled states of the system and analyze them. But you can understand that this is very difficult to do if you increase the number of spins. So even if you have 100 spins, the dimension would just simply blow up and you can't do it on a conventional computer. That's where we want to introduce renormalization-like methods like DMRG to solve these systems. And how do we do it? Before we go to how we do it, there are some methods people do use to solve these systems. People use effective Hamiltonians. In effective Hamiltonians, you basically assume that your excitations are so low that you can just keep two or three of the energy levels and throw away everything else. And you can be certain that the higher energy levels would not be occupied. Then you have quantum trajectories and Monte Carlo methods, in which instead of solving a Lindblad-Yund, you only need to solve the non-Hermitian Hamiltonian of the system, along with things like quantum jumps. So this scales your problem a bit, because instead of solving a Lindblad-Yund, which is the square of the dimensions, you just solve the Hamiltonian with some losses adjusted to it. It's a very interesting technique. Again, you have MPS methods, where instead of just solving the system, you solve the entire Hilbert space of the environment. So, and these are very useful techniques in studying molecular light matter systems and things like the groups of Martin Plenio, as well as the groups in Munich, they use this a lot. Again, you have other smaller methods like approximate semi-classical methods. So you derive the semi-classical equations and just you can use bits of quantum fluctuations on it. And again, you have methods like permutation symmetry, where if you assume that all your spins are homogeneous, then you can use the symmetry of the problem, similar to a Bethe answer or something like that, to reduce the solution. But none of these methods actually work in the general case. You need very specific systems with very specific assumptions to make it work. So for our case, that's why it was important to develop a new method or a new approach to solve the system. And what we basically did is we used a variational renormalization group. Now, what do I mean by that? Typically in quantum states, you have a large Hilbert space if you have n equal to 100 spins or something. And if you want to solve the time dynamics of the solution, you need to look at the unitary dynamics of the system. But we know for many body quantum states or even quantum states in general, that if your state is weakly entangled, you can actually represent this entire system in a very renormalized or truncated space. And this is exactly what happens when you solve for the Ising model, as well as a lot of 1D systems. Because your ground state is so weakly entangled, you can actually renormalize and present it in a much smaller basis, which allows you to use DMRG and MPS-like methods. And this is very obvious from the Schmidt decomposition. So if you have a state psi, which lies on this large Hilbert space, and if you break it into two parts, A and B, the dimension of A and B would actually depend upon how strongly these systems are entangled. So if your system is maximally entangled, then the dimension of A and B is the same as the dimension of what the dimension of the subsystem exactly is. But we know from the Schmidt rank that if your system is not maximally entangled, if it's weakly entangled, then this dimension can be much, much smaller than what the actual dimension of the system is. And this is what we use, what most people use when they are, when they think of variational renormalization group methods like DMRG, MPS, or tensor networks. The same idea can now be extended to density operators, where instead of looking at unitary dynamics, you're looking at the open dynamics of the system. Now, instead of the large Hilbert space, you have a large super operator space where your density operators lies and operations on your density operators, like the Lindblad operators, they all lie. And in a similar way, instead of weakly entangled state, you can think of weakly correlated states. And this was done by Zwolok and Vidal, where they defined what these weakly correlated states look like. But if you are in the weakly correlated regime, you can again renormalize and go to a much, much smaller Hilbert space. And this is exactly the assumption that we will use in our method. So how do we go about it? You can think of spins inside a cavity. And this basically maps to a central body problem because all the spins are interacting with the cavity and not talking to each other. So you can write this as a central body problem, and then you can divide your entire operator space into a system and an environment. Since your cavity is your central body, you don't actually normalize the cavity, but you can renormalize the system as well as the environment. And by renormalize, what you can do is, depending on the correlations in the system, you can reduce the dimension from 4 to the power s to some small number d. Similarly, so you can effectively decrease the dimension of the system from 4 to the power n to 4 to the power d square. And that's the central idea of applying the variational renormalization group. How do you apply the dynamics? You can represent the dynamics in terms of your Lindblad operators. And what you can do is you can split this Lindblad operator into piecewise applications. So you can make them interact with each of the spins individually. And once you do that, so you have a central body, you can decompose it using Suzuki Trotter decomposition. So this is something a bit mathematical, but it's general for all matrices. So if you have a evolution of the form of E, you can split it into different parts this way. So basically splitting it into each, so evolution of the cavity with a single spin at any given time. And if you can split it in this way, then all that remains of your evolution is to do this in a piecewise manner. So in a single sweep, you apply your evolution to each and every spin individually. Right? So this is a very, very superficial introduction to the method. But if any of you are interested in knowing the technicalities, I would be happy to explain it later. So let's go to the results. What do you get? So this is the spectral frequency comb that we wanted with 105 spins. So it has a strong collective effect. But okay, and these are the solutions that we get after applying the renormalization method. So you can see we already get collective effect. We get these strong revival and collapses that we had observed earlier in quantum memories, but we now get it even in our system, even though we don't have a huge number of spins. So you get a good collective effect. You see a very strong mesoscopic effect. You can see that the fluctuations in between these peaks, if you plot the same thing in a log scale, you can see there are a lot more fluctuations when you have few number of spins. As you increase the number of spins, you can see that the fluctuations actually go down, and the tendency from going from few to many actually allows you to have sharper revivals in the system. And the third plot is basically the spin excitation. You can see how the energy is exchanged coherently between the spin and the cavity. And the period with which this is happening is basically the period with which the spectral frequency comb was designed. Okay, but this is all collective effort. Did we get any quantum out of it? The thing is, we calculate the second order correlation function and we look at the statistics of the light. Now you can see that the light is actually sub-Poissonian statistics. You're getting non-classical light that's coming out. So even though you have gone to 100 spins, but since you've exactly solved your system, now the quantumness of it is coming out. So in the semi-classical case, the classical part was the assumption that the light is classical, even though the spins are quantum. In this case, you can see that the light is purely quantum. And you can not only do that, you can actually force the G2 to go to very, very low values. So what we get is, we get an unambiguous single photon. Yeah, sorry. Was there a comment or?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Yeah, yeah, sure. I'm actually on.
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Yeah, five. So I think I'll finish before that. So yeah. So this is, you get into the unambiguous single photon regime because it's already less than half, but this is an experimental regime. But if you see that, even if you look at the higher correlation functions, if you look at what the G2, G3 and the G4 function is, you basically have all of them going to zero. So in some sense, you can use this pulse to, you can use this system to create a non-classical pulse train of light. Okay, so what we did was we looked at a mesoscopic ensemble and then we put in a brief pulse of light as an input. And in the output, you could actually generate a completely non-classical collective form of light in the system. So that was a way in which you could get the collective features as well as the non-classical and quantum features, and you could collect the two regimes together. So in the future, we are looking at a few more experiments. So this is something we started a long time back, but we are not, since I moved to Imperial, we've not been able to finish, but it's very close to getting done. So you can see what you can do is you can have a similar system and you could put a cat state inside. And if you look at the video on the right, you'd see what happens to this cat state. So if you start with an initial cat state, this entire cat state dissolves into the ensemble. And now it's stored in the ensemble. And after some amount of time, the ensemble will throw it back to the cavity. So it's acting like a quantum memory for a cat state. So you have an initial cat state which you've put in, which you don't know where it's been generated in some other part of an experiment, but it's coming to the ensemble and it's being stored in the ensemble for a certain period of time. And after a certain period of time, you can retrieve the entire thing. So it acts as a nice memory. And second, we are also looking at how this entire thing can be done. Instead of designing spectral combs, can you non-classically, can you control the input light in such a way so that you can generate non-classical light? Okay, so the takeaway message from this talk is we use techniques like variational renormalization group, which has its roots in quantum information theory, in many body physics, to open up some kind of a new direction to look at in light-matter interaction, especially in hybrid quantum systems. So mesoscopic systems allows you to look at quantum features while still going to a large number of spins. So it allows you to increase the effective coupling. It allows you to get a lot of collective effects while still giving you some quantum features. And it also opens a connection with the larger tensor network community. So there's a lot of people who work on MPS and these things in many body physics, in spin systems, in condensed matter physics. And it allows us to borrow those tools and apply it to light matter interaction. Secondly, it allows us to look at non-classical light in mesoscopic ensemble. And this would actually allow us to look at a lot of other interesting photon statistics that you get. You get unconventional photon blockade, super bunching, and a lot of different kind of interesting physics that can be explored, super radiance, among other things. And it also allows us to address some fundamental questions. So there's always been a question about how do you scale with n from the from the microscopic to the semi-classical thermodynamic limit? And having this mesoscopic ensemble in between can actually bridge this question a bit and look at some questions and see what is that number n where you can safely go from one regime to the other. Okay, so these are the people I collaborated with. So Matthias is still a PhD student in TU Wien. And Dimitri, he was a senior postdoc in a group, but he's now moved to the industry and he's based in Munich right now. And Stefan was the professor in whose group we were working. And we were supported by a lot of different funds. So I personally had a Lisa Meitner fellowship to work on this project. And so thank you.
Thank you, Himadrida, for the talk. There are three questions in Zoom. Do you want me to read it out, or you can see the chat box?
I can maybe.
Should I read it out?
I have the chat here. How weak correlation ensured in the system so that DMRG is validated? Okay, so this is a question that people ask me a lot of the times. So sometimes when you're applying DMRG, it's not necessary for you to know beforehand whether the system is entangled or not. You can calculate the entanglement on the run. So in our case, we know that the system is weakly correlated because we don't drive it strong enough so that all the correlations come up. So we try to stay in the regime which we know is weakly correlated, and we calculate this correlation in real time as the code is going on, and it gives us an error. And if the error starts building up, we know that it's not working anymore. So you can think of all the spins to lie on a block sphere. And when they are unexcited, they all lie at the bottom. And as we excite them, they start slowly moving out. So as they move out and go towards the equator of the block sphere, they start getting more correlated. So in our case, we have to ensure that we are quite close to the bottom. But since we have so many spins, that already ensures that you have sufficient excitation to study the system. Okay, I hope that answers the question, but yeah, we can discuss later. And what's the second one? Which follow area law, what property of superoptics? Okay, yeah, so again, so area law tells you, this question should go the other way. Like, area law tells you that it will work in spin one system, in one dimensional systems for sure, because that's like a general law to say. Like when DMRG was first developed, people didn't know why it works. People had no idea from the quantum information angle. It was only when I think Matt Hastings came and said that, okay, this is the area law for one dimensional systems, and this is why DMRG will always work here. And as area law fails, DMRG will not work. But you can still try doing it. You can still apply DMRG to places where area law doesn't hold, as long as you're sure that you're not going somewhere that the error is too much. So in our case, even if there is no specific area law, we can control how much correlations is building up as time goes on. And there are some systems where you can actually just simply do the calculations and know that correlations will not be beyond a certain point. Okay, Aditi, Aditi, this is a very interesting question. So the paper by Zwolok and Vidal, as well as there's a paper by Animesh Datta and Vidal, where they actually try to connect the correlations with something like Discord. So if I remember correctly, in some cases that exactly works out to be like Discord, but I'm not sure if it's generally true for everything. So yeah, this is something, yeah, like, I think for some system they showed it is similar to Discord. And the last question is, when you talk about subpoisonian statistics, what kind of environment have you considered? No, you actually don't need a specific environment. So Aditi, could you just clarify the question if you're on speaker?
What I said that you have some graph, right? Where you show that this, light, I think, just one. Exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, so you said that you got sub-Poissonian statistics, which actually demonstrate the non-classicality of light. And so we already got a quantum kind of feature we can see even in mesoscopy system. So what I said that if you, I think that you your approach is this by Lindbladian that you try to solve, right?
Yeah.
So somehow in the Lindbladian operator, you have this dissipation term and other terms, right?
Yeah.
So what kind of dissipation term have you added? Or this property will remain same if you have a different dissipation term, for example?
So in our case, it's a bit different. So if you think about it, what I'm doing is I'm actually solving for the spins as well as the light. So the dynamics between the spin and the light is actually non-Markovian dynamics. Mm-hmm. So the losses that I've taken are just the losses that come because the cavity is not perfect. So it's just a Markovian kappa, which defaces the cavity, or photons are being lost. And the other loss that I've taken is where the spins are losing due to, again, like something that can't be accounted for. So these are just simply Markovian losses. What you can do is you can even reduce the system further and throw away the spins. And if you throw a trace of the spins, then you'll have a very complicated non-Markovian Lindbladian to do it, to work with.
Okay.
So to answer your question, like the first environment that goes into our Lindbladian are just very simple, ordinary photon loss terms, like it would just be Ka dagger A, which basically means that photons are lost once in a while,
uh-huh,
or spins are flipped once in a while. It's a simple defacing terms.
Okay. No, I was just thinking that once, suppose I keep on increasing the environment part. So in some sense, there will be more and more losses I count.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
somehow your non-classicality or the sub-Poissonian statistics should move to Poissonian kind or something, like non-classicality may vanish or something.
Yeah. So Poissonian light can also just simply disappear here by increasing the photon number. So if you keep pumping and you increase the photon number a lot, then the light would, just by increasing the number of photons, it would start behaving like a coherent source.
Okay.
So in terms of the environment, I'm not sure about how that would work out. It could even work to be like, it could even engineer something else that would make it more quantum. So it's difficult to say.
Another, just one comment, question also related to Ganesh, because I understand that you were solving the Lindbladian equation. So in some sense, you were more interested on the system part, right? Because you have a huge system and environment together, right? So really in this approach, there is a point of area law, because you have to consider area law when you have a pure state, right? When you have together system or something, system environment together. So.
Yeah.
Really, in the variational, this the Lindbladian approach really, maybe not area law, but some other thing should play a role.
Right? No. So that's what I'm trying to say. Is area law gives you a very clear, if you have an area law,
exactly.
It would surely work.
Yeah,
But you can have complicated systems, like if you're doing, say, PEPs for square lattices, where you really don't know what the area law would be.
Exactly.
You can still try to do it and look at what the error is.
Yeah, then you should be more careful about the error. Yeah.
Yeah. In all cases, maybe the area law as such is not clear. If you have an area law, that's like brilliant. But
yeah,
maybe. And in our case, what happens is, since we just take simple Markovian losses, so it's a very generic form of losses. So it's very difficult to create the entire environment in some sense. But there are people who, what they do is, supposing you're working at how molecules behave within themselves, or something like how Martin Plenio's group, they work on these energy transfer systems. And in that case, you can actually take and engineer the entire environment around you and look for area law in the larger Hilbert space.
Exactly.
In that case, you will have a much more clearer answer as to what. But I'm not sure even if in that case they actually know what the area law is. But you can apply DMRG to the larger Hilbert space, and in that sense, some area law will take place.
Thank you.
So a small question from my side as well.
Yeah.
So,
do you want me? I just
when we're talking about this mesoscopic number of spins, say 100 of them. So these spins do not interact with each other, right? They do not talk to each other.
Yeah.
Take it.
Yeah.
And a small question about your second last slide. So when you are talking about this memory thing and talking about the preserving these cat states, have you just checked something like this negativity volume of the Wigner function, that how much non-classicality is getting preserved in the memory or something like that?
So that was exactly the Wigner function, and you could see that the negative part which comes down, right? That was the plot of the Wigner function.
Yes.
So you could see that the Wigner function is highly non-classical, and
yes,
then it gets absorbed and you just have something classical in the cavity, because all the non-classicality is in the ensemble now. And after another period of time, the entire non-classical light again comes back to the cavity. So what's happening is, when you initially put the state is in the cavity, and then it goes to the ensemble. And then the ensemble keeps it coherently for some time. And after a particular period of time, it would again release it to the cavity. So it's like the Rabi oscillation in some sense you see in chain's coming model, but at a much different scale. So it's just coherently exchanging between each other. And this is exactly what you want, right? Supposing you have a quantum protocol in one corner.
Okay.
And that's
thank you so much.
Is here. Yeah.
Thank you so much for the talk. Yeah. And we are running a bit late in time, so I would welcome Chirag. Could you please share your screen?
Hello. Yeah.
So the next speaker is Chirag. He is from HRI. He works with Ujjal sir, and we'll be talking about resource theory of quantum coherence with probabilistically non-distinguishable pointers and corresponding wave particle duality. So now
okay. So can you hear me properly? Hello?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So hello everyone, and so first of all I would like to thank the co-organizers and the advisory committee for organizing this Young Quantum online. And secondly, I got the opportunity to present our work. So thanks for that as well. So let's go. So this work was done in collaboration with Sritama Das and my supervisor, Professor Ujjal Sen. So let's go ahead. So we know that any PO state can be expressed as a linear superposition of set of PO states forming a basis in the Hilbert space. For example, this state psi in a Hilbert space can be expressed like this in the superposition of set of states I which form basis in the Hilbert space. So physically, systems prefer a fixed basis. For example, consider the Young's double slit experiment and suppose the experiment is done with photon and the state passing through the upper slit is denoted by zero, whereas the state passing through the lower slit is denoted by one. Therefore, the state present at the screen is a linear superposition of zero and one. So this is the natural basis for this particular experiment, that the states passing through the upper slit and the states passing through the lower slit. So coherence is a quantity which is used to quantify the amount of superposition present in a quantum state with respect to a given basis. So a given basis is therefore is a demand, because physically system prefers fixed basis. So coherence is very useful in various areas like quantum entanglement, quantum computations, and quantum thermal machines, etc. A formal resource theory, and it was known from very early, but a formal resource theory was formed not very late in 2014 by this Plenio and the group with respect to orthonormal basis. So a brief review of which is given like this. Suppose you have a basis 0 and 1, which are orthogonal to each other in the Hilbert space of dimension 2. Then a resource theory, first of all, comprises of free states, free operations, and suitable measures for the resource. So in this resource theory, free states are actually are given by the convex combination of the states forming the basis 0 and 1. Whereas incoherent operations are the operations which take all incoherent states to incoherent states only. Few examples in this particular case is amplitude damping and phase damping channel. And for coherence measure, they have shown that the relative entropy of coherence and L1 norm of coherence are good measures of coherence in this particular case. So going ahead, so they considered the resource theory with in an orthonormal basis. So later on, people also generalized this thing and went on to consider linearly independent basis in these in the following works. Here, our aim is to formulate a general framework where a so-called basis can have linearly dependent set of quantum states, which are all which we are calling as probabilistically non-distinguishable pointers, because they are not even, and they are not distinguishable even probabilistically. So what is the motivation of considering a basis which has which can have linear base, so-called basis, a linearly dependent set of quantum states? The first motivation that we get is that coherent states that arise in quantum optics actually form an overcomplete basis, and they are very useful in dealing with the states that are prepared in optical systems. By this I mean that any states as well as the operators arising in the quantum optics can be expressed in terms of coherent states, and they are more than complete, means they form a linearly dependent set, and they can be used to express any quantum state arising in quantum optics. And therefore, a non-zero coherence of a quantum state in this overcomplete basis is potentially an expression of a non-classicality or coherence that we consider. So second motivation is that we know that in quantum computations, magic states, we know that are very helpful for universal quantum computations. Because with the help of stabilizer states, so magic states with the and along with Clifford operators, one can perform universal quantum computation. And for a qubit system, magic, a resource in the resource theory of magic states, magic is usually defined as the distance to a certain bitetrahedron within the Bloch spherical representation of the qubit state space. So see this Bloch sphere. Here, the edges of this bitetrahedron are actually the eigenstate of the Pauli operators, all three Pauli operators. So the convex hull of this forms a set of states which are non-magic states, which are not useful for universal quantum computation. And the sets falling outside can be used for universal quantum computation along with the help of Clifford operation. So they act as resource, and magic is also defined like the distance from this tetrahedron, the minimum distance from the tetrahedron to that magic of a state is defined as the minimum distance of that state from the tetrahedron. So we'll see that coherence will define in general basis in the similar way, that it will be the distance from the convex hull formed by the basis elements of the basis that will be considered. Therefore, magic turned out to be coherence in a special case. So let's go on to formulate the resource theory of coherence with respect to a general basis. So the free states or the incoherent states, suppose a basis consisting of pure states, n pure states, in the Hilbert space of dimension d, then the free states have the form like this, where Pi is the probability. If Pi is form set of the Pi, set of Pi's form probability. So the next thing that usually comes in a resource theory of coherence is the incoherent operations, the free operations. So suppose phi be a completely positive trace preserving map, CPTP map, then it is said to be coherent if phi of rho f belongs to set of free states. This is a set of free states denoted by FB. for all rho f belonging to fb. So this will be called then free operations. And furthermore, a CPTP operation can be represented in Krauss operator represented like this. And incoherent operations under any post selections means for any I, if this operation takes the state to a free state for all free states, then it is said to be incoherent operation under any post selections for any I. Yes. So in our paper we have this is mainly our first result in which we showed that for the case of three qubit states, the incoherent operation, we gave a necessary condition on the incoherent operation. So if the incoherent operation is expressed like this, then this is the condition that they must follow to be an incoherent operation in the case of three qubit states. Next, we demand two properties for a measure to be a valid coherence measure. That is, it should be greater than or equal to zero, and the equality holds only if and only if rho belongs to the set of free states. And the coherence measure should decrease under any incoherent operation phi. So a good coherence measure satisfying both those properties can be a contractive distance measure for the state rho for which we are measuring the coherence with respect to other state sigma which belongs to a set of free states, and the minimization is taken over all the sigmas such sigmas. So this is our proper definition of a coherence measure. Relative entropy of coherence is a contractive measure under CPTP operations. So this is also valid here. This is also a valid measure here. And for the case of qubits, the trace distance is also equal to the Euclidean distance between the states in the block ball. And also it is a contractive under trace preserving operations. Therefore, this also forms a valid measure for qubits. And this is given like this. Now we go on to the next section in the resource theory, where we show that measurements how do measurements produce incoherent state in a resource theory of coherence in a general basis. This will be useful. The usefulness will be seen later on. So first, let's get in theorem. So for any set psi I running from 1 to n, where n is greater than d is the dimension of the Hilbert space where psi I is belong. It is always possible to find a POVM that has psi I as its outcome, with possibly some outcomes that need to be ignored. So case one, consider that this set of psi I's, the convex hull of this set of psi I's contains the maximally mixed state. In that case, the POVM elements will be given like this, where this pi tilde is some particular pi tildes which add up to which when summation over ai dagger ai is done, then add up to identity. And in other case, when this convex combination of psi i's does not contain id, then one can extend the set from I is equal to 1 to n to I is equal to 1 to n, such that now the convex combination contains identity, and again the POVM elements will be given like that in this form. But because we want only the outcomes 1 to n as the measurement outcome. So we will one can ignore the other outcomes in the measurement, like from I is equal to 1, n plus 1, n plus 2, dot, 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 to n. So how to get incoherent state in this basis? So so these are the steps. Perform the measurement AI, I running from 1 to m on any maximally mixed state. The outcomes will be psi i's with probabilities pi tilde. Because remember, AI had this form root b pi tilde psi a. So if you perform a measurement on maximally mixed state with respect to this measurement, then the state, the outcome will be psi i's with probabilities pi tilde. Now ignore other outcomes n from n plus 1 to m, and partially ignore the outcomes from I is equal to 1 to n such that an arbitrary probability distribution qi for psi i may be obtained. Therefore, you can and if you ignore the measurement outcomes now, then using one so then the state will be this with arbitrary qi and this is equal to psi i. So it will be a convex mixture of psi i's with arbitrary probability qi. So you get every incoherent state using the measurement operators ai's. Now coherence theory is based on measurements. So this is a different thing. So first of all, in the standard resource theory of coherence, the incoherent states are diagonal in fixed orthonormal basis of d-dimensional Hilbert space. But this can also be seen as coming out of von Neumann measurements, say PI, rank one, which are rank one projectors of the states of the chosen orthonormal basis. These orthonormal basis. So the free states of this resource theory with respect to orthonormal basis can also be generated using projective measurements, where the projectors are the projectors of the states from this basis, orthonormal basis, and sigma is any state in the Hilbert space. So if you perform measurement in the orthonormal basis, then you will always get the free state of the resource theory. So there are two directions in which resource theory of coherence is considered. One is resource theory based on superpositions, and another is resource theory coherence based on measurements. So the generalization in the case of superposition is done by lifting the restriction on the orthogonality of the basis, whereas the generalization in the case of coherence based on measurements is done by taking higher rank measurements like higher rank PVs, projective measurements, or POVMs. So these are the works considering resource theory, lifting the restriction on the orthogonality of the basis, and these are based on the measurement. So structurally, resource theory of coherence defined with respect to a basis, is different from what you define with respect to measurements. So in measurements, what happened? When you define it with respect to basis, first the free states are defined, the quantum coherence measure is defined, and based on distance of a state from the set of incoherent states. Whereas resource theory of coherence based on POVMs are first, in this case, quantum coherence measure of a state based on POVM is defined by resorting to a Nyemark extension of the POVM to a projective measurement in some higher dimensional Hilbert space. So you, in this case, what happens is that you have a quantum state and you have a measurement, so POVM. So you take Nyemark extension of that to a higher dimensional Hilbert space, and such that the POVM becomes projective measurement, and you use the coherence measure for coherence measure that is defined for projective measurements, and the same coherence measure will be for the POVMs. So this is different structurally from this. An example can be shown. An example is shown in our paper, where we take 3 qubits, and in the resource theory that we consider, the free states are the states falling on the convex plane, on the plane formed by the convex combination of these 3 states in the Bloch sphere representation. Whereas in the POVM theory, since I showed that set of states can have POVMs such that they are outcomes. So POVMs can be formed out of these chi naught, chi one, and chi two, like this, and whose outcomes are chi naught, chi one, and chi two, and based on the resource theory of coherence based on the POVM, one can see that the free state form a null set. So clearly these two resource theories are different, because one might think, right, because in resource theory of coherence with respect to orthogonal basis and resource theory of coherence with respect to projective measurements of rank one, they are parallel, they are same. So one may think that for a resource theory based on linearly dependent state, they may have some link with resource theory based on POVM, but the way we connect, we don't see any connection between them. In the next part of our work, we studied wave particle duality in the superposition of 3 qubit states. So, first, what is wave particle duality? It's a fascinating phenomenon of quantum mechanics, also described as Bohr's complementarity principle. And it states that the wave nature and the particle nature are complementary to each other. And few works which in the literature attempting to quantify complementarity are listed here. So the wave nature of any quantum system, also can be called quantum, is quantified by coherence, quantum coherence, in the context of double slit experiment. And the particle nature can be quantified by the distinguishability of the detector states corresponding to the different path followed by the quantum. So consider this setup. In this setup, there are two slits, and there is one leaking machine such that, so first of all, the states passing through the slit, upper slit, is denoted as 0, and the state passing through the lower slit is denoted as 1. Then the upper slit has a leaking machine with unleaking probability of R and leaking probability of 1 minus R. And after, in this leakage path, the Hadamard gate is implemented such that the state becomes equal superposition of 0 and 1, that is plus. So at this stage, the unnormalized state is given like this. So one is able to superpose a linearly dependent set of states. Now, these states interact with the detectors present at some place here, and all the detectors we take in the same state D, in the Hilbert space of dimension 3. So the after interaction, the joint state of the quantum plus the detector can be like this, because there exists a unitary. You can show that there exists a unitary interaction unitary which can take this state along with the detector state to this state, a joint state. So what is the relevance of this state is that it tells that the detector state is D0 when the quantum takes path 0. The detector state is D plus when the quantum takes the path plus, and detector state is D1 when the quantum takes the path 1. So to find complementarity.
Chirag, you have 5 minutes left.
Okay, thanks. So to find complementarity between the wave nature and the particle nature, first we calculate coherence of the state, coherence of the system. For this, we trace out the detector part from the joint state, and then take a normalized measure of coherence whose maximum value is unity. So the coherence is obtained like this. And for distinguishability, you again trace out the the quantum part, and you get the detector states. But the problem is that detector states have non-diagonal terms in the basis D0, D plus, and D1, which actually are associated with the path 0 plus and 1. Therefore, an unambiguous discrimination is not possible here. So to make an unambiguous discrimination between the detector states, we perform a probabilistic phase damping over the state rho d, given like this, consisting of operators a0, a plus, a1, a question mark. So these operators have this property that ai acting on di for I 0 plus and 1 is non-zero. Otherwise, it is zero. So therefore, AI can be associated with the path I for I is equal to 0 plus and 1. And A question mark is discarded because this when acting on rho d will again give us off diagonal terms. Therefore, discrimination will not be possible unambiguously for that resultant state. Therefore, this can be discarded, and we only keep the operators corresponding to I is equal to 0 plus and 1. So the detector state, therefore, using von Leuter's postulate, is given like this, because we are discarding this A question mark operator. And the upper bound of unambiguous discrimination between these mixture, so this is a mixture of pure states, can be calculated using upper bound. The upper bound is available for unambiguous discrimination between mixture of pure state, and let us denote that by P. So the actual path distinguishability should be the distinguishability between the mixture of pure state P and the probability with which A0 and A plus and A1 happen and A question mark don't happen. So the distinguishability is given like this. So this is the probability of discarding the A question mark operator from the phase damping operation. So this should be multiplied with P to obtain the actual part distinguishability. And we showed numerically that this normalized coherence of the joint state, normalized coherence of the quantum and the distinguishability of the detector state, it takes the maximum value 1 and always remains less than 1. And if one does not take in account the probability of the discarding A question mark, then this sum can go to a non-trivial value, C tilde plus P equal to 2. So therefore, since the phase damping was probabilistic, so this is the relevant thing to study. And it is, so we obtain that wave particle duality is also appeared here in the case of coherence with non-probabilistically distinguishable pointers. So now I summarize that we considered a resource theory defined with respect to a general basis and studied various aspects of it, resource theoretic aspects. We also saw that the magic in quantum computation is a kind of coherence in a particular basis. We demonstrated that the resource theory of coherence based on general basis is different with resource theory of coherence based on POVMs. We also demonstrated that the complementarity between coherence in a superposition of linearly dependent set with the path distinguishability of quantum states. Thanks.
Thank you, Chirag, for the talk.
Okay.
So there is one question from YouTube. Can you see the chat box or should I?
Yes. Why the previous detector state was D plus? Is this question relevant or not? The previous detector state. Yeah. It is just denoted by D plus. Let me share the screen once more. So we demand that the interaction between the quantum and the detector is such that it takes to a joint state of this joint state of quantum and detector to be like this, because we want that that when the quantum takes the path zero, then the then detector has some state D zero. So it is just one is denoting it by D zero or D plus. Nothing special in it. Means just that.
Okay. Maybe one final question from the chat box.
In which case C plus D will be equal to one? Since I optimized it numerically, there are various cases for it. We checked that it goes to one. So in one, there is no unique case for which C plus D goes to one. So there is no unique answer to it. Yes.
Okay. If there are no more questions, we thank again Chirag and Himadrida for their nice talks. And now I hand over the mic to Aditi for any announcement and proceeding to the next poster session.
Yeah. So, okay. Thank you very much, Aptoshi, for chairing the session. And thank you, Himadri and Chirag, having a nice talks. And now I hand over the mic to Shiladitya, who will be chairing the session, poster session. Shiladitya is from HRI. So Shiladitya, are you there?
Yes.
Okay.
So let me start the poster presentation session. Welcome again to everyone to the interesting session of poster presentation. Personally, I like this session in every conferences, because as we, in this particular session, usually we come across the youngest generation of our community. And really, I am feeling honored to share this session. So as you have already know, the rules and regulation for the sake of completeness, let me repeat again. We have 8 presenters in this session. Everyone will be given 5 minutes. And after 4 minutes, I will give you a reminder. And you have to, if you finish within time, I will take some questions. Otherwise, all questions will be in chat box. And at the end of all talk, we'll take one by one. And whoever we will write in question in chat box, mention to whom you are addressing the question. Now I call according to the order given in the schedule. If I did not get response someone, I will go to the next speaker. So remain alert with your presentation. So you have first speaker, Pia Batra from IZER Pune. Are you there?
Yeah.
So please share your screen and...
Yeah. Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Katha.
Yeah, okay. So, hi guys, thank you for the organizing this conference virtually. So, today I'm presenting a recent work that we have done, and the title of the talk is the Characterizing Quantum Evolution Using a Recommender System. So it's a recommender system is a machine learning technique that we use to characterize quantum evolution. So it's like a classical algorithm of recommender system that we are using for quantum data. So here our data is quantum. So how this algorithm works, I'll briefly give you an idea. So if you see in figure A, if you have heard about recommender system, it's a system that has been used by various websites and by various websites where they recommend you a particular product based on your previous transactions.
Okay.
So. Okay, I think there is some background.
Yes, you carry on. Please mute the person, computer center.
Yeah, so as you have seen in some website, these websites give you recommendation based on your previous transaction and based on your previous choices. So it means if you consider a user movie kind of scenario, that you have watched a particular kind of movie and you haven't watched a particular movie, then your recommender system can be a tool where it can give you the recommendation for the unknown movie. So if you see there are some question marks, it means those ratings are not known for the user. So we train our algorithm so that recommender system can work in such a way that we can get these question marks. It means we can get the unknown ratings of the matrix. So we translate the algorithm to, in our quantum case, where our users that we have shown in the rows, that is like quantum state, and our movies that we have shown in columns, that is our unit trees. So it's something like this, that you have a particular quantum state, you can find the correlation of that quantum state. Now there is a unit tree, you apply that unit tree on the quantum state, you go to some another quantum state, and then you can find the correlation there. So whatever difference of correlation is there, we are taking that as the matrix element in the matrix, that is denoted as delta C11, that is for first element in the matrix. And there are some unknown elements that we can't figure out, and we want to calculate those unknown elements using this algorithm. So since it's a small talk, I won't go into the details of how to get it, but I can simply say that it's mostly a gradient algorithm. So you can make a cost function and then you can calculate gradients. And based on the gradients, you can update your matrix. So it's something like that. Since you have some other correlations, so based on that correlation value, so we know how rho1 reacts with u1, how rho1 reacts with u2, and how rho1 reacts with u3. And we also know that how rho2 reacts with u4. but we don't know how Rowan reacts with U4. So we try to take these correlation values from Rowan U1 matrix to Rowan U4.
1 minute.
So, yeah. So this is the main algorithm that we talk about. So I won't go into the mathematics of the algorithm, but I'll just show you some results. So this is the result that we are talking about. So here we are taking all three kind of correlation. We are taking three kind of correlation. One is discord and another two is type of entanglement. The measures of entanglement. One is entanglement entropy and another one is negativity. So we do it for unitary two-qubit evolution and we show that. So here we see that blue line is your actual value that you should get, and this red ones are the fluctuation whatever you are getting using your algorithm. And we see that even if you put a lot of unknown elements within the matrix, and even when few elements are unknown, so as it has been shown on x-axis that 5 × 10⁻⁶, so it's a 1000 × 1000 matrix, and out of that 50% elements are not there. And even when 50% elements are not there, you can actually predict the value within a good efficiency, and your error is not that much. So we can do that for all kind of correlations. So it's very helpful for the quantum simulators and some kind of experimental techniques where you don't have all the measurement setup and you can't actually measure all states. But if you I'll just complete this. So it's actually important for the experimental techniques where you can't measure all the quantum states after evolution. So you can just do all simple kind of evolution and try to build a matrix where some elements are known and another unknown elements you can calculate using machine learning algorithm. So yeah. Okay, since the time is not there, so I'll just say that for all the further reference, and if you are interested, you can check out the work on the check out the poster at the website, or you can drop an email. Thank you.
Thank you, Priya. I think you stay here. If any questions comes, I will add you later. So I move to our next speaker, Manoranjan Sai from NIT Rourkela.
Yes.
Are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay. So please share your screen.
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So can I start now?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So good evening, everyone. So first of all, I should thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present my work here. So my work is based on experimental study of multi-qubit entangled states using IBM quantum computing platform. So this is a plan of the talk. Actually here we represent our work on a particular well-known state known as perfect W state. So perfect W state is a 3-qubit entangled state, asymmetric class of W state. And it has interesting applications in perfect teleportation, supervised coding, and splitting and sharing of quantum information. So this is the motivation behind the work, because the state has interesting applications. And so physical realization, experimental implementations of the state and its useful applications should be useful for quantum information processing tasks. So our objective behind this work is to first the experimental generation of perfect W state, then the state characterization by full quantum state tomography, then detection of presence of genuine non-locality between the 3 qubits that will be used using Marmion inequality test. And finally, I would like to show an application of splitting and sharing of quantum information using the state. For our work, we choose IBM quantum computing platform. IBM has provided free access to wide class of researchers, and there are free to use devices using also simulators. We have chosen one of the 5-qubit real device IBM Vivo to perform our experiments, and the architecture of the device is shown here, which gives an idea how to construct algorithms and to apply single and 2-qubit gates on the qubit. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 here presented are the qubits with initial state 0. So based on this architectures, this is the algorithm that shows the application of single qubit and 2-qubit gates on the 3 qubits Q0, Q1, Q2, which are initially at gate 0. And the operators, the unitary matrices that are used here can be found. The details of this matrix can be found from this page. So the output of the algorithm that is shown here, which is obtained after many sets of experiment, each of which was run for 8192 trials, 8192 sorts. And this circuit actually shows the generation of the entangled state, but we have to characterize the state, means we have to measure the efficiency of generation. So the efficiency of generation means to measure its efficiency or to quantify it, we are calculating fidelity of the experimentally generated state. The fidelity can be measured by constructing the experimental density matrix, and the experimental density matrix can be obtained by taking the full quantum state tomography and then using the Stokes formula shown here. In our case, we obtained a fidelity of 0.75 plus minus 0.02, and this completes our generation part. Next, we try to look at means how much non-locality is there in between the entangled qubits. So for that, we consider Marmin inequality state, inequality test, and one of the form of Marmin inequality is shown here in equation 5. When we calculate Marmin polynomial, we got around 2.516 plus or minus 0.027, which is more than the classical bound, that is less than or equal to 2, as shown in equation 5. So the final part of our work is to show an application with this experimentally generated state. So the application is splitting and sharing information between three parties or 3 qubits. So the information is initially carried by Alice, and later it is, suppose there are 3 parties, Alice, Bob and Charlie, who share the entangled state, perfect W state. The information is initially carried by Alice, and later it is splitted into
1 minute
by Bob and Charlie. However, none of Bob and Charlie can retrieve the information alone. The process is like Alice will share the information, but Bob and Charlie cannot retrieve information. They cannot both simultaneously retrieve the information. One have to be the controller and one have to be the receiver. In our case, we consider Charlie to be the controller and Bob to be the receiver. The whole process can be explained from this figure. The first part is the state generation part. So Q1, Q2, Q3, the 3 qubits are shared by Alice, Bob, and Charlie respectively. And the first work is to generate the entangled state, entangled channel between them. So W state, we are using perfect W state. A stands for the arbitrary state, which is held by Alice. What Alice does in the second part, she takes measurement with respect to Bell basis measurement, and the information is split into 2 parts between Bob and Charlie, but none of them can retrieve the message alone. U is the unitary operation here, which is used to make, this can be used to make any one of them as the controller and other the receiver, but here we are particularly choosing Q3, means the qubit held by Charlie is the controller, and this unitary operator projects Charlie's qubit to get 0, and Q2, Bob's qubit becomes the receiver. And then finally, by some control measurements and Z basis measurements, we can have Bob's output. And to characterize again the Bob's output, means to know the efficiency of this process, we again calculated fidelity, and the state sharing fidelity, means which is the output of Bob, is calculated to be 0.805 plus or minus 0.006. So in this work, we looked at one particular state, perfect W state, and its creation and application. This concludes my work and presentation too.
Okay, thank you. Even again, just your time, I will take question later. I move to next speaker.
Okay.
Please, Mohan, from...
Yes, Iluda.
Okay, share your screen.
Yeah, can you see my slide?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So first of all, I would like to thank our UQ organizers. So the title of my poster is Reverse Quantum Speed Limit. So since we know that quantum physics has several inherent limitations, this limitation could be either operational or dynamical. Here I look in the point of view of this dynamical. Dynamical point of view. So in the dynamical point of view, the quantum speed limit is one of the dynamical limitations, and this has a very important application in ranging from quantum computation to quantum control and even in quantum thermodynamics, etc., etc. So these limitations are not only crucial for the theoretical questions but also have some practical relevance. So as recent years we have witnessed in the rapidly developing quantum technologies. So what is quantum speed limit? So quantum speed limits answer the following question: how fast a quantum system can evolve in a time? So quantum speed limit defined as the maximal dynamical evolution speed of the quantum system. It determines the minimal dynamical evolution time required for a quantum state of a quantum system to evolve from an initial state to the target state. So if we consider the projective Hilbert space and if two pure states are given, psi t and psi t delta t, which are in infinitesimally separated, and then we can write down this Fibonacci matrix. So you can see on your screen ds square is equal to 4 and this term in the bracket. So if we want to measure the distance between psi 0, which is an initial state, and psi t, which is the final state along the evolution curve, which is determined by this Fibonacci matrix. So after integrating, I'll get this s is equal to 2 by h cross and 0 to 2 delta h dt. So delta h is here is the just a variance of the driving Hamiltonian. So and we can, if you differentiate this, since s is the distance between two initial and final state, so as we ds by dt will give the evolution speed in the state space. So further, if you integrate this integral, and if this driving Hamiltonian is time independent, then we can write this expression s is equal to 2 delta h into capital T by h cross. If Hamiltonian is not is time dependent, then we can replace it by delta h bar, where you can see the expression of delta h bar in the right side in the bottom. And then now we can write our evolution time in the following way: t is equal to delta h cross s by 2 delta h. So as you can see that the this evolution time depends on the fluctuation of the Hamiltonian and the distance between initial and final state. But our direct observation, we can see that this psi 0 and psi t, the distance between them is defined by s naught, which is known as the Bragman angle. And this is the geodesic distance between two points in the Hilbert space. So this inequality s is greater than s naught gives rise to lower bound on the evolution time. So t is greater than or equal to h cross s naught by 2 delta h, and this h cross s naught by 2 delta by 2 delta h, we call it the speed limit time. So the evolution time in the quantum speed limit is lower bounded. So similarly, one can ask the question, how slow a quantum system can evolve in the time? To answer this question, we have introduced a notation called reverse quantum speed limit. So this is defined as the minimal evolution speed of closed quantum system, and it says the bound on the maximum evolution time required for a quantum state of a closed quantum system to evolve from an initial state to the target state. This is an upper bound on the quantum evolution time, and the quantum evolution will be slower if the reverse speed limit time will increase.
We have 1 minute left.
Yeah, just okay. So we can in the Hilbert space, we can define two unit vectors, this chi t and psi t, and their inner product will induce a metric in the projective Hilbert space, And then if we'll integrate them, then we'll get these two length, L of chi t and L of psi bar. And so as we see that this L of psi bar is nothing, just equal to the Fabinet steady distance as we seen earlier, but only the there is a factor of two. We can ignore this factor of two because and then consider this factor of two just in order to have the distance between two orthogonal states must be pi. So here I'll drop this factor. So we can write this t is equal to h cross l psi bar by delta h. And then we'll use this inequality l of chi bar, this inequality, and to set the upper bound on this evolution time. And this, so you can see this, this time evolution time is upper bounded. And with the upper bound is, we call it the reverse quantum spirit limit time. So we can say that the in the quantum mechanics, the evolution time is upper bounded and lower bounded as well. Similarly, we can obtain this this bound for mix initial state as well of using the purification protocol. And you and this bound you can easily verify in any dynamical evolving dynamical system, even in the two level system. And for further details, you can look our poster, or you can drop a question in the chat box, or you can see our this paper. So this is the conclusion. So I'll not read it. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Brijwan. Please stay here. So far, not any no any questions. So I go to next speaker.
Okay, thank you.
Pranay Barkataki from Visheshwaraya NIT Nagpur. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
So please share your screen.
Hello.
Yes, yes. I can see your poster. You can start.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, organizers, for organizing such a wonderful online conference. The topic of my presentation is generating two-qubit Wonder state by superposing dimer and random states. Here we superpose state phi 1 and phi 2, where phi 1 is nothing but the tensor and tensor product of 2-qubit dimer state, as shown in the equation in red. And we have a state phi 2, which is nothing but the random state, where AKs are chosen from a normal distribution. This state phi 1 and phi 2 and the normalized superposed pure state is given as such, the state psi, where C is the normalization constant, because phi 1 and phi 2 are not orthogonal to each other. The dimer structure of the phi 1 state is shown in here, where it is nothing but maximally 2-qubit. Now for going further, for very large values of 2n, extremely large, the 2-qubit reduced density matrix of the state psi can be given as such. The equation you are seeing in purple is the 2-qubit reduced density matrix, where rho ij dimer is nothing but the 2-qubit reduced density matrix of phi 1, and rho ij random is nothing but the 2-qubit reduced density matrix of state phi 2. The other incoherent term goes to zero for very large values of 2n. That mathematical part details are not shown here. Now, what is this rho ij random? How do you let the matrix structure of this rho ij random cross four matrix, if you've seen the equation in blue. Now, and we consider any of the typical diagonal element as shown R00, and any typical off diagonal element of this matrix, it is R10, where the subscript Q is nothing but the summation terms of the block that is 2^(2n-2). 2n power is the space of the dimension of the Hilbert space, and 2n-2 are the qubits that are being traced out. So remaining only 2 qubits. So we calculate the ensemble averages of these summation terms of the diagonal and off diagonal elements. And these summation terms, the average of the summation terms for the diagonal elements comes out to be 1/2^2n. We have solved this multi-dimensional integral and some non-trivial calculations. So at last, finally, it comes about 1/2^2n. Now, we have also solved the calculated the off diagonal terms, and the ensemble average came out to be zero. Finally, the density matrix, reduced density matrix of rho ij random looks like I/4, which is nothing but the maximum mixed state for a 2-qubit system. So finally, for a very large values of 2n, the rho ij, which is the to be reduced and written as such, the equation in blue, which is nothing but our famous two-qubit Wörner state. Now, this happens exactly when the values of 2n is very quite large. And as we know that the concurrence value, which is a measure for a two-qubit pure or a mixed state, the concurrence value expression, the mathematical expression, can be given as shown in the color magenta. And here you can see, this is for two-qubit Wörner state. Now here you can see that if the sine square theta value is greater than 2/3, greater than equal to 2/3, then at that case, the concurrence value goes to zero. Why I'm iterating, why I'm saying this fact, will be coming few slides. Now, what I do, equation, I substitute theta equal to π/4, and for very large value of 2n, the ideal two-qubit reduced density matrix should look like such, as you could see here. Now, we have numerically computed what will be the two-qubit reduced density matrix for n equal to 16 and 2n equal to 26. And as you could see, if you compare this two-qubit reduced density matrix with the ideal two-qubit reduced density matrix, you could see that as the number of 2n increases, the numerically computed two-qubit reduced density matrix exactly approaches more towards the ideal two-qubit reduced density matrix.
You have 1 minute left.
Yeah, sure. And we also calculated the concurrence between the first and the second qubit versus 1 minus p. 1 minus p is nothing but sine square theta. And you can see from this graph that if 2n equal to 20, 2n equal to 6 or 2n equal to 10 for low spins, the concurrence values before 0.66 or after 0.66, before 0.666 or after 0.66. But for large values of 2n, like 2n equal to 26, it approaches, it almost goes to 0 at 0.666. 0.66 is nothing but 2/3. So this observation and this calculation reinforces our we have already discussed back. This is the screenshot of our, this is the screenshot of my paper, which was published in International Journal of Theoretical Physics. Thank you.
Thank you. You end with in time, but no question to you so far. If any question comes, I will address later. Then now we move to next speaker, Sohail from HRI. Yes. Are you here?
Yes, yes,
I'm
here.
Here is.
Just wait on it. I'm very nice. Yeah, so actually my screen is visible.
Yes, your screen is visible. You can start now.
Okay. Yeah, so this is the actually title of my talk. Actually witnessing non-separability of bipartite quantum operation. And I have done actually this work in collaboration with Professor Ujjwal Sen. So basically in this work, actually, we provide a method for witnessing non-separability of quantum processes, and actually with the help of Choi Jamiel-Koske isomorphism. Okay, so yeah, these are some basic definitions and theorems. I will not go through this. And then this is a relation between entanglement witness and Hahn-Banach theorem. So this says that basically, separable actually state form actually convex compact set, and Hahn-Banach theorem says that actually for such a case, actually there exists a functional which can distinguish actually point actually inside this set and the point that are not inside this actually set. Okay, so yeah. And Choi Jamiel-Koske isomorphism, this is basically an isomorphism between the space of actually super operator and how to say this, and the tensor product of actually their underlying actually spaces. Okay, so that's so Yamil Kosky isomorphism. And channel state duality, it says that actually any CPTP map can be viewed as actually state in a higher dimensional Hilbert space. So actually, as an example, if actually we have actually quantum operation actually which are acting on n dimensional Hilbert space, then actually those operation can be viewed as a state in actually in an n square dimensional Hilbert space. Okay, so and separable operators or separable super operator are those for which the Krauss operator are of this form. Then yeah, so actually using these all thing, we have actually shown that the Choi-Yamiel-Kosky isomorphism is continuous, and the set of actually separable operation is convex and closed. So like the case of entanglement, which actually witness, we can also actually find the witness for actually the set of actually separable quantum operation, actually non-separable quantum operation. Okay, so and we have done this thing for three gates: C not gate, square root Schwab gate, and Bell gate. Okay, and actually the local decomposition of the witness operator are of actually this form for the three gate. This is for C not gate, and this is for actually square root Schwab, and this is Bell gate. And then we have done noise analysis. And we have shown that actually, actually our method can detect non-separability of the noisy map of this form, provided that actually p is greater than 1/9 for C not gate, and p greater than actually this thing for actually square root Schwab gate, and p greater than 1/9 for Bell gate. And actually the usual detection method. Actually detects the non-locality or non-separability when p greater than 1/3. So the noise tolerance is actually much higher in our method.
Yeah, one.
Yeah, that's all. Yeah. So thank you.
Okay, you can read your conclusion if you wish.
So actually, in conclusion. Actually, basically, we have actually find a method for actual detection. Actual detection of non-separability of quantum operation, and the noise tolerance is much higher than the usual thing. So actually, that's all for.
Okay, thank you. You finished also within time. I also cannot see any question to you, so stay here. If any question come, I will come to you later.
Okay.
Now, okay. I move to Shashank Gupta from S.N. Bose Institute. Are you here?
Yeah, Shulada.
Yes. So you share your screen now?
Sure. So is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible. Let's start.
Okay, so good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me an opportunity to present my work. Today, I'll be talking about demonstration of tripartite quantum steering using sharp logical contradiction. I would like to use this opportunity to thank my collaborator and my mentor, Professor Archan S. Majumdar. So the concept of steering comes in asymmetric networks. So in the tripartite network, there can be two kind of asymmetric network. First one is one-sided device independent network. In such a case, one of the three parties is uncharacterized. Here, let us say that first party Alice is uncharacterized. So by uncharacterized mean, the Alice does not have any information about his subsystem. She doesn't know the dimension specifically and how it subsystem works. So what she can control on only the input. So she gives the input X and gets the outcome A. But the two other two systems, the subsystem B and C, are well characterized. And in the one-sided device independent scenario, if the assemblage, the unconditional, unnormalized conditional state formed on the subspace of Bob and Charlie have such a decomposition, which is called LHS decomposition, then we say that this assemblage sigma AXX on the Bob and Charlie side is unsteerable. Whereas in the other asymmetric network that we call two-sided device independent scenario, there are two uncharacterized subsystems, which we have taken as A and B. So in this case, A and B, the dimension of subsystem A and B are unknown. So what they can have, the probabilities when the input X is given in the subsystem A, the subsystem gets outcome A, whereas for the subsystem B, the input given is Y and gets the outcome B. So based on these measurements, the unnormalized conditional state that is formed on the Charlie's subsystem is denoted by this assemblage sigma AB XX YY. If this assemblage has such a decomposition, such LHS decomposition, then we call these assemblages as unsteerable assemblages. So now we will demonstrate this tripartite steering using logical contradiction. Okay, so for this purpose, we consider the GGHZ state, which is non-maximally entangled, pure GHZ state. The observables that are chosen, so we are considering the two-sided device independent case. For this purpose, the observables that Alice perform, first observable is sigma X, second observable is sigma Y, and A and B are the outputs of Alice and Bob, and there are two outputs. The observable on Bob side is Y0 and Y1. So there will be a total 16 assemblages components that are obtained on the Charlie side. So corresponding to X0, Y0 observable, these four assemblage components are obtained. And for other measurement combination, total 16 assemblage components are obtained. Out of these 16 assemblage components, 8 assemblage components are independent. Now, if if this this assemblages has LHS description, then this this should satisfy this thing. So if we add all these assemblages, then what we get that 2 times the conditional state obtained on Charlie's side is equals to the 1 times the conditional state, so which shows the contradiction, and hence this subsystem, this system is steerable and demonstrate the tripartite steering in two-sided device independent case. So using this, obtained the fine-grained inequality, which is a generalization of inequality given in this paper for the tripartite case. So I'll just say the first term. So this is the combination of 4 conditional probabilities. The first term denotes the probability of getting the outcome 0 when Charlie performs Z0 measurement. Given that Bob and Charlie has performed measurement X0 and Y0 and obtained the outcome 1-1. So using this, we have demonstrated the genuine entanglement certification. We have certified the genuine entanglement. So it involves two processes. The first process is that if the shared state is a 3-qubit state, we have shown that the maximum violation of this FGI inequality, which is 4, certifies that the shared state is a genuine entangled state. But in the two-sided device independent case, if the dimension of the first two parties is unknown, then we have shown that if such a state maximally violates the FGI, then the shared state is the direct sum of copies of 3-qubit genuinely entangled state. So what the other future directions that we are working in, we are trying to see whether the sharp logical contradiction can be given for multipartite quantum steering. And we are also looking for the demonstration of self-testable GGHZ state using this FGI inequality. Another future direction that I have not mentioned is whether this sharp logical contradiction can be used to demonstrate genuine multipartite steering. So this is interesting. I'll stop here. So yes. Thank you, all the participants, for listening to me.
Thank you, Shashank. No question to you. So next speaker, Pooja Thakur, I think she is not attending. So therefore, I move to the next and the last speaker of this session, Kritika VR from IJAR Pune. Are you here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. You can.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Please share your screen.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, your screen is visible.
Okay. Can I start?
You can start now. Okay.
Okay. Good evening to everyone. And first, let me start by thanking the organizers for moving this conference online this year and giving me an opportunity to present recent work here. So today, I'll be talking about NMR implementation of a phenomenon which is seen in Rydberg atoms, that is Rydberg blockade and freezing. And so let me start. I'll give you a very brief introduction to Rydberg atoms, which are atoms excited to very high energy levels. And why this is of interest is because at these energy levels, they display enhanced radius dependent properties like dipole moment, polarizability, and many more. And consequently, they also respond give stronger response to electromagnetic fields and interact more strongly with nearby atoms and so on. So this makes them very good test beds for studying many body physics and for implementing quantum information protocols and so on. So today we will look at two phenomena, which is Rydberg blockade and freezing. So to give you an idea, suppose we consider two independent Rydberg atoms. They are initially not talking to each other, and these are two level systems, let's assume. And this is the Rabi frequency of each of them. And if we see their energy level distribution, this is how it will look, where we have both of them in the ground state and one in the excited and the other in an excited state and both of them in an excited state. So when we now drive them on resonant, we will have populations being pumped from the ground state to the excited state via these intermediate energy states. So in essence, we'll have population cycling from GG to EE and back and so on. And our transitions are on resonant, and this translates to such a picture where we again have populations going from GG to GEEG and EE and back and cycling. This is when they are not talking to each other. But suppose we bring them close enough that they can now interact with each other. And being Rydberg atoms, their interaction is stronger at higher energy levels. And by virtue of bringing them in contact or introducing this interaction, this energy profile changes. What happens is there is a van der Waal interaction that now comes into picture, which is radius dependent, and this shifts the energy in such a pattern. So earlier, a transition which was on resonant, like this transition is on resonant, but this second energy from E to 2E is now no longer on resonant with the radiation that we apply, because of which it goes out of resonance. And if we see the Hamiltonian, it is we can express it in a plus minus basis. And in this case, we see that whatever population is there in GG moves to an entangled state, which is the plus state, and it's oscillates with the enhanced Rabi frequency. But now EE is completely cut off from the dynamics by virtue of this interaction introduced between the Rydberg atoms. And when we recast the Hamiltonian in this basis, we also see that the minus state doesn't participate in the dynamics. So effectively, we have managed to block out some energy levels, which is why it's called Rydberg blockade. And continuing in this regime, if we reduce the driving strength on one qubit, we can further selectively drive only just a single qubit of interest, where here if you see this qubit is being driven very strongly as compared to this. So population will now translate only between GG and GE more than it doesn't have an opportunity to go to EG that much. So this gives us a lot of selectivity, and even when they are interacting. And this was a phenomenon which was recently introduced by Vinisha and Ankita, who are students of Professor Rajeshnath, and their group introduced the theory behind this. And so to see the mathematical formulation, the Rydberg Hamiltonian can be expressed at excited state with a detuning. And this is the Rabi frequency term. And this is the interaction between the atoms. And this was the case for non-interacting atoms, where we assume that there is no detuning at the highest energy.
You have 1 minute left.
Sure. And this is the Rabi frequency term and the interaction, which is zero for non-interacting case. But when we have Rydberg blockade interaction introduced, our V0 is now introduced into the picture, and it is very strongly interacting as compared to the Rabi frequency. And in which case we have our Hamiltonian recast into this plus minus basis and an enhanced Rabi frequency. And for freezing, we again have interaction, and the Rabi frequency of one qubit is much less than the other. So we incorporated this mechanism, these phenomena in NMR, where we have interacting qubits, which is this Jij is the interaction between the qubits. We have a static field and control over the Rabi oscillations through an RF that we apply. And by performing some mathematical calculations, like expressing these projectors in terms of spin operators, we see that there is a correspondence between the NMR Hamiltonian and the Rydberg Hamiltonian, a direct one-to-one correspondence. So using the NMR architecture, we can explore these phenomena, and which is what we have done here. We have shown experimental results for 2-qubit and 3-qubit systems. I'll explain the results for 2-qubits in detail. So if you see here, the first one is when they are not interacting with each other. The y-axis are populations. So here, once we start with population in GG, over time as we evolve, we see that the population goes to EG and the black is for EE. So population is coherently exchanged between GG and EE, as is expected. But once we introduce interaction between the 2 qubits, we shouldn't expect any population in EE, and only an exchange between GG and the psi plus entangled state, which is exactly what happens. As we see, the blue line and the maroon line are the only ones which are exchanging population, whereas the other two are completely, they remain zero almost. And the last two are for freezing, where we drive a particular qubit at a higher Rabi frequency strength as compared to the other. So only you see only the excited state of that particular qubit and the ground state exchange populations. And to quantify this, we studied discord between the 2 qubits. And as we can see, plus state for 2 qubits is the maximally entangled state. So discord is maximum in this case. But for freezing, where it doesn't go to a maximally entangled state, there is still some discord generated, but it is not the maximum. And we could reproduce similar results for 3 qubits, where we see blockade, where excited states are cut off, and selective driving of only a particular qubit during freezing. So, freezing is not it's just not a coincidental phenomenon. It can be quantified, where if we slowly increase the driving frequency on the second qubit, we see that the population does start to transit to it more. So it's not a chance phenomenon in that sense.
We sought. We began.
Conclude? Yeah, done. So we have demonstrated Rydberg blockade and freezing phenomena with have great use in quantum information processing and quantum many-body physics applications. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kritika. So we have all the speakers presented their talk, and I think to present your work within 5 minutes is very challenging task compared to presenting in 20 or 30 minutes. And I think every speaker accomplished their job very smartly. Now, I will come to the questions. So all the speakers are here. I start with the first, Priyavatra. There are 2 questions. Priyavatra, you are here?
Yeah.
So I will read the question, or you will see?
Yeah, I'm reading it. I can read it.
From first question.
So first question is from YouTube. So Okay, so we have tested our algorithm using some known data. So we had a particular system size, a particular system, and for that we calculated everything, and based on that we deliberately made some of the values unknown so that we can actually test whether algorithm is working or not. And the second question is, and with how large data set the testing was done? So we have done it starting from 10 quantum state and 10 unit trees to 10 to power 4. So final data was 10 to power 4 cross 10 to power 4. So that was maximum.
Okay.
So I think second question is from Aditi. I understand the method can be used. Okay, so we have used this algorithm for 2 and 3 qubit, and both are 2 and 3 qubit Ising model. So we have calculated negativity for Ising coupled systems.
Okay, so if any question to Pia Bhatta, anybody, you can on your microphone and can ask. Now I move. The question to Mona Ranjan again from Aditi Sende.
Yes. I can read the question. Okay. Ma'am, actually both W state and JJ state shows interesting quantum correlations, but W states are more robust when particle loss is considered, and particularly this type of W state that we have considered here, although it is not maximally integrated in 3 qubits, but as shown by Professor Agarwal and Professor Pathy, this W state is useful in achieving unit fidelity in teleportation and perfect means dense coding.
Is it okay, Aditi?
Yes, it's fine, because that is true that in it is actually AES to BC bipartition, this has maximal entanglement, as you mentioned. But it's true that in a particle loss that becomes separable. On the other hand, the state is not. And so maybe that will be used. I mean, you just I understand that you haven't considered that usefulness. You just consider the fidelity, how to generate them and what is the fidelity of the states, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Next, I move to question from Aditi to Pranoy. Pranoy?
Yes, I'm here.
So, do you say that the nearest neighbor density matrix approaches to Varna state? What about other two body states? Do you know, or can you comment on that?
Yeah, actually, that's a very good question, actually. The 2-qubit reduced density matrix becomes a Varna state only in the case when I and J qubits are in the same dimer. So if they're in a different dimer, then it become I by 4. So even they are in the one I is nearest in one dimer and J is in the nearest another dimer, then it will become the maximally mixed state I by 4. That we have also calculated. I may not have said that in the presentation. I've not shown in the presentation actually, but in the paper we have shown that calculation based the total reduced density matrix become I by 4.
Yeah, but if you have, suppose you have a state which is 1-2, I mean, suppose all the dimers are there and you consider 1-3, then you know what is the state?
Yeah, ma'am. Then also the same thing we have seen for any. I go for. So it's anything other than that is not in the same dimer, then it will not come as such. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. I think in next question, Shoshang has answered here in chat box. Have you any question already to Shoshang?
I got it, because I understand that it can be applied for 4 qubit. And okay. Thank you, Shoshang.
Yeah, I would like to extend a bit. For 4 qubit, there can be 3 semi-device independent scenario. So whether it is possible for all 3 cases, that I suspect. But yeah, for other measurement setting, it can be shown. But still, for the specific state that we can say, we cannot say that for all state this method will work. but for a specific state and for a specific measurement setting using this method, tripartite steering, this steering can be shown, but genuine steering can be shown using this method is interesting and also challenging to show, but we are working on this.
Yeah, but even in 3-qubit, you cannot show for W state?
We have not, yeah.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so next question from Himadri. Rydberg blockade can be increased to many N atoms. Will the freezing also work for N atoms?
Yeah, so actually for 3-qubits, we have done that. In the 3-qubit case, we freeze 2 at a time and we show that the dynamics is restricted only to 1-qubit, the one which is driven strongly. And we have also done experiments where we have frozen only one and driven 2 of them. So freezing can also be extended for an N atom scenario where we can selectively drive only a few qubits of interest and or atoms in this case.
Can I add a question?
Sure.
Yeah, so I want to ask you something. So you are simulating the Rydberg blockade using NMR, right?
Yes.
But the Rydberg blockade is a very strong property of the Rydberg atom itself.
Yeah.
So how would you mimic the blockade using NMR? Like you would have
to... Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so essentially what we need for simulating blockade is we have non-interacting systems and then we need to introduce an interaction. So in NMR also, we have qubits which interact with each other. They are, have a coupling strength, which we can tune to some extent. So in for we can completely decouple them so that they don't talk to each other.
So and, you're just artificially cutting off, you're artificially introducing a blockade.
We make use of the inherent interaction between the 2 qubits to simulate it. So these 2 qubits are already talking to each other, in which and we use this interaction equivalent to the interaction between the Rydberg atoms.
No, I mean like if you get the 2 qubits close together, the blockade yeah. would come naturally, right? You have to decouple.
Yeah. So if we relative to the driving strength, if the interaction strength is much stronger, then it will automatically be present in the system.
And one more thing is, in the freezing, how do you deselect one of the levels? Both the levels have the same energy, right?
Sorry, can you repeat?
Like if you have the EG and the GE level.
Yeah.
How can you, like you can drive one, but you don't drive the other one. But they are energetically very similar, right? They don't have any broadening. Like how do you do that?
No, so these are two different qubits. So it's like one is of one nature and the other is a different qubit. So by virtue of the J coupling, these energy levels are actually not degenerate. There is a slight shift between them because of the interaction term. So we still have that selectivity in our system.
Okay, so you can select GE and not EG or
the other. Yeah, exactly.
Well, thank you. The next question also, I think, to Kritika from UG.
What kind of atoms this was tested and performed? Is it applicable for every type of atoms? So this was done for NMR qubits where the spins are placed. These are nuclear spins placed in an external magnetic field and they are natural spin offs. So they are two level systems. And because of the coupling, we can have like two types of nuclei coupled or three and so on. And is it applicable for every type of atom? That would depend. As long as you have freedom in your architecture to tune the interactions between them and apply Rabi type oscillation, if you can realize Rabi oscillations and tune interactions, then I think it should be extendable to different platforms. Does that answer your question?
Okay, but the question who make the question cannot respond here because it is from YouTube. I think you said the question. So thank you again. And
thank you.
To all the speakers of the session. I think there is no more question. So I'll end the session here. And over to Aditi, I microphone give to the Aditi for some announcement.
Yeah, thank you, Shiladitya, for chairing the session. And thank you, Shoptoshi, and all the speakers in this session. Interestingly, there are many organizers actually spoke in this session, including chairpersons. And I must mention that Himadri, although this time he is not the organizer, but he was the organizer, co-organizer of one of the first UQ 2015, and also co-organizer lot of duty he has done in our first conference in QIC at HRI, the 2011 QIPO. So I really thank everyone for giving time. So we have around 40 minutes. After that, there is a keynote talk by Professor Anton Zeilinger from Vienna. So stay tuned. Chandan?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can stop streaming, right?
Sure. Okay, fine.